Well, in this final session, we want to think about a woman that we know as Jane Grey. Lady Jane Grey is the way she's often referred to. She was queen for about 10 days. There's a book called The 9-Day Queen, and it's probably off by a day, but be that as it may. When I first began studying church history, it would have been in the year 1974 to 1975, I had a typical of seminary programs. I had a survey course in Church History 1, fall term, and then the spring term would be Church History 2. I suspect at the end of that term, that year, if you had asked me, so who are the prominent figures in the history of the church, I certainly would have been able to name a variety of men, Athanasius and Augustine and Anselm and Aquinas, Calvin, Luther. But I'm not sure I would have been able to name a woman. In fact, at the time when I was taught church history, I don't think it was by design, but I think if you'd asked me, so what role did women play in the life and history of the church, I probably would have been able to not really answer that question. I didn't really think about women's roles in the life of the history of the church. In fact, I think the way that those who taught me church history, good men, good teachers, but unwittingly gave me the impression that church history was basically about a variety of theologians talking to each other and responding to each other. And certain church histories in the past have been written that way, where you get these very prominent figures, and these figures are very, very important. It's amazing the influence that a Luther and a Calvin would have. I think it can be rightly said that after the Reformation, nothing was ever the same in Europe. Calvin changed everything, his life, his thought. I think one could easily argue that the United States of America, as it is now, given its history, would not have been the same if John Calvin had not lived. Humanly speaking, obviously, I'm not talking here in terms of the providence of God. And one of the dangers of that is it gave the impression that really women were there, but they were not major players on the scene of church history. During the 1990s, for a variety of reasons, I began to realize that that approach to church history was not helpful in some ways. It occurred to me as I was teaching classes with women in them, do they identify with these men? It really never occurred to me until probably somewhere around 1990, and I started to realize that there's an element missing in my teaching of church history, and I began to do something that I think we all need to do in our own different callings. We need to re-educate, you know, the idea of continuing education. I especially think, and this is off to the side, that that's very important for pastors. I think one of the dangers we have is we give a young man in his 20s a theological education, and then he has the impression, I can run on that for 40 years. No other area of expertise has that idea. There needs to be retooling, re-education in terms of, you know, chucking the past, but building on that. And so I began to teach myself the history of women in the life of the church, and it became very evident to me that women have played a critical role. I knew that from my own life in terms of my wife. But I didn't translate that into my teaching. And so it was that I began to read the lives of various women and see the significant role that women have played. Certainly not maybe, you know, in the limelight, but the church would not have been the church without the contribution and lives of these women. And if you want biblical justification for that, you'd simply need to read Romans 16. And let me encourage you, pastors, preach a sermon on Romans 16, verses 1 to 15. It's a list of names. But what a list of names. 26 names, 9 of them are women. Where Paul commends a variety of women as workers in the gospel. I'm a complementarian in my convictions, but I do fear sometimes that those who embrace biblical understanding of roles of men and women in the church have sometimes failed to recognize that God has used greatly godly women in the life of the church, and I fear that sometimes the pendulum has sometimes swung over to the other extreme, as it were, and we've lost sight of the fact that women have played a vital role. So part of what I'm doing this afternoon is to show, we've looked at two prominent theologians, Cranmer and Tyndale in the English Reformation. In my opening talk, we noted Luther particularly, but I don't want to leave you the impression that the Reformation was primarily about theologians talking to each other. It was about the truth of the gospel, which bears upon the life of every human being, men, women, children. And we want to look at the way that the Reformation impacted the life of a young woman in her early teens. The second thing, really, I want to do in some ways, and if you're asking why has he chose Lady Jane Grey, is also, and I didn't realize what Pastor Coker would speak on, about the importance of youth in our congregation. We're looking at a woman who is 16, barely 16, when she makes really a confession of faith that seals her faith in blood, and she hits all of the key issues of the Reformation. And it's a reminder to us how vital it is that we pass on the faith to our children. And that in their teens that they can express justification by faith alone, sola scriptura, those sorts of truths, they're not simply for theologians or pastors. They're for men and women in the pew. And so some of what I'm doing here is just an encouragement to continue teaching our children the truths and doctrines of the faith through various means, catechism, and so on. I begin with the date, February the 10th, 1554. We're in the Tower of London. You can still go to the room she was imprisoned in. Lady Jane is the person I'm thinking of here. She has been queen for a little over a week the previous year. She has been imprisoned by her cousin, Mary the First, who I talked about a little bit in the previous hour. Interestingly enough, in that room, if you go there, as I have been there, you can actually see Jane Grey carved her name into the wall. I'm assuming it was her, not somebody else who came after her. I'm not sure why somebody else would want to write her name in the wall, but maybe. But every indication is that she actually carved her name into the prison cell there. There's quite a number of names. She's speaking to a man named John Feckenham, F-E-C-K-E-N-H-A-M. There is a sheet in your package that you should have, two-sided. We're going to go through the whole thing eventually. And I'm going to begin and read down for the first part of the argument. John Feckenham's real name is John Hounham. He came from a place called Feckenham and had adopted the name John. Really, the real name would have been John of Feckenham or John de Feckenham. And he's known to history as John Feckenham. He's not a well-known figure today. He was in his own day. He was renowned as a skilled apologist for the Roman Catholic Church. He had debated John Hooper, who Martin Lloyd-Jones once described as the father of Puritanism. And he had also debated a great Anglican theologian named John Jewell. And so he was a gifted theologian in his own right. He was a man who knew how to hold his own ground with theologians. As we will see in this discussion with a 16-year-old, he is bested by this 16-year-old young woman. Feckenham is there. He may well have been with others. A number of people who've looked at the text say there probably might have been others there as well. And in some ways, this might have been kind of a mini debate. It's not well known, that there were a number of major conferences during from the 1520s all the way through to the 1560s. It's not until the end of the Council of Trent, when Rome has fixed her doctrine, that those sorts of debates come to a close. There's a number of debates that take place between Reformation figures, Roman Catholic figures, and this may have been like one of those. But Jane says she wrote this down after the debate. This was published in the very year of her death, published not long after her death. And thus, if it were not true, there would be those around who could have indicated it's not being true. Everything in it speaks that this is Jane's own theology and thinking. Thickenham began the debate. What thing is required in a Christian, Jane, to believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost, three persons and one God? It's interesting she begins with the Trinity. Thickenham, is there nothing else required in a Christian but to believe in God? Jane, yes, we must believe in him. We must love him with all our heart, with all our soul, and all our mind, and our neighbor as ourself. Thickenham, why then faith justifies not, nor saves not? He immediately goes with a jugular, as it were, this major issue of debate between Protestants, evangelicals, and Roman Catholics. Jane, yes, verily, faith, as St. Paul says, only, and I put there in square brackets, that's my explanation, alone. She means faith alone justifies. Thickenham, why St. Paul says, if I have all faith without love, it is nothing. 1 Corinthians 13 is obviously what he's quoting. Jane, true it is, for how can I love him in whom I trust not? That's a very important little point. That when we believe on the Lord Jesus, it's not bare intellectual belief. There is an attraction to him. There is a love for him. Or how can I trust in him whom I love not? Faith and a love agree both together, yet love is comprehended in faith. Thickenham, I'll come back to that. This is a very important point. I'll come back to that. Thickenham, how shall we love our neighbor? And to love our neighbor is to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, give drink to the thirsty, and to do for him as we would do to ourselves. Thickenham, why then is it necessary to salvation to do good works? It's not sufficient to believe. Jane, I deny that. I affirm that faith only saves. But it is meet, proper, for Christians, in token that they follow their Master Christ, to do good works. Yet may we not say they profit to salvation, for although we have all done all we can, yet we be unprofitable servants, and faith only in Christ's blood saves. Here very, very clearly is set forth by a woman who is not a theologian, who was not a pastor. She did have privilege, yes. She had privileges that many in England did not have. She had been raised, as we will see, in aristocratic circumstances. She had tutors. She had the opportunity of correspondence with theologians on the European continent. But nonetheless, we have here a very clear, distinct statement of what it means to be a Christian. That it is faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Faith that is not simply intellectual, but is trust, and that entails a delight in and a love for the Lord Jesus. One of the great errors that emerges in the 18th century is an error that is known as Sandemanianism. If you don't know what Sandemanianism is, you can look it up easily online. You need to read two books. One is the great little article that was a paper that Martin Lloyd-Jones gave against it in the 1970s. He actually begins it by saying to a group of pastors in London, I suspect that probably nobody here hardly knows what Sandemanianism is, and probably many of them did not. It's the idea that we are saved merely by faith, and even if we never do any good works, it's easy believism is really what it is. And the other great thinker who demolished it would be Andrew Fuller. It's very significant to see it here in the words of Jane Grey. Well, let me ask then, who is this woman? How did she end up in this position? I want to say a little bit about her history. I want to come back to this document and go through it. It hits three critical points, as we'll see, about the Reformation. Jane Grey was the great-niece of Henry VIII. Henry VIII's favorite sister was Mary. This can get confusing. There's Mary, Queen of Scots. It's not her. There's Mary I, who's his daughter, and then there's his sister, Mary Tudor. And Mary Tudor had a daughter named Frances, and Frances is the mother of Jane Grey. She married a man named Henry Grey, the Marquis of Dorset. The historical record stands to show that this couple, Frances and Henry Grey, were not a particularly nice couple. They were power-hungry, social climbers, determined to use their children to advance their own political power and status. She was born in 1537, Jane Grey, the very same year as Edward VI, who is her cousin. Jane was probably named after Jane Seymour, Henry VIII's third wife. And she grew up then in fairly favored circumstances, and she would eventually be named as the fourth in line to the succession of the throne. Her parents were determined to get her married to somebody important, and as she entered into her early years, 7, 8, 9 years old, they determined they wanted her to marry Edward, the future Edward VI. She'd be Queen of England. They'd have significant clout and status being the parents of the queen, and so they gave her a tremendous education. They taught her French and German, Italian, Greek and Latin. They had a tutor who would come in and teach her these things. And then, typical of that period of time, they would also give her dancing lessons and needlework and all of the various refinements that a woman who possibly could become queen would need. Then they sent her off to court at the age of 10, about 9 or 10, and she went to live with Catherine Parr, who is Henry VIII's now sixth wife. It was one of Catherine Parr's servants who said, "She was a woman of rare goodness. Every day in her house was like a Sunday." That tells you a number of things. It tells you something about Catherine Parr. It also tells you something about Sunday. Sunday was seen to be a delight. And every day was a day of delight and pleasure, according to the servant living in the household of Catherine Parr. There is very clear evidence she was a believer. She published a book regarding her Christian life. It's been republished by PNR. I didn't see a copy downstairs. It's a great book. You should buy it if you can. Brandon Witherow, a pastor over in Toledo, Ohio, edited it. And it very clearly shows her to have been a woman who embraced the gospel. It was in her household that Jane Grey comes to a living faith. It was in her household that the future Elizabeth I comes to a living faith. And all of the achievements of Elizabeth I, and those of us who love the Puritans have tended to see Elizabeth as something of a negative figure, but she was a remarkable queen, and remarkable achievements for the English-speaking people. And Catherine Parr stands at the heart of that. And Catherine Parr was used by God to deeply influence Jane Grey, even though Jane Grey only lived in her house for 2 or 3 years. In 1547, Catherine Parr died, and her household was dissolved, and Jane Grey came back to her parents. Her parents were furious at her. She's only 10, but they expected that she would have made some headway in possibly moving towards engagement to Edward. She's only 10 years old. It didn't matter to them. We're told they beat her, physically beat her when she came home. But she had already opened correspondence with a number of men. Can you imagine this? A 10-year-old writing to Heinrich Bullinger, the great reformer in Zurich, or Martin Bucer, who was in Strasbourg but was then living in Cambridge. I mean, I would have been thrilled if my children were writing to, you know, John Piper and John MacArthur. It raises a question, too. I mean, would these theologians actually took the time to respond? That's also significant. I think that's a very good lesson for people in Christian leadership. How easy it is, you know, you think, oh, you know, just a little kid or not that important. But you never know how God will use that correspondence. And so Jane returns home. From the parents' point of view, she's a failure. She continues to grow and learn. We have a number of stories from that period of time. One story is very striking. She's out for a walk one day with her cousin, Mary. Mary, who will become her queen, who will become queen after her, and actually Mary, who will condemn her to death. And they're walking behind a chapel. And Mary suddenly curtsies about the very place where behind the chapel, the altar would have been in the chapel. And Jane is probably about 12 years, 13 years old. And Mary is a good 20 years older than her. And Jane turns to Mary and says, for what did thou curtsy? Oh, well, because the body and blood of my Lord are there in the on the altar, and we must kneel before him. Oh, she said, don't you know it's just bread and wine? That strikes me, she said, as a species of idolatry. As is a 13-year-old already understands some of the deep things of the theological debates. In the spring of 1552, and as I mentioned earlier, Edward falls ill. He has measles. It will eventually undermine his constitution, and he will die of tuberculosis in 1553. As he's dying, he's determined that Mary would not succeed to the throne, and so he changes the line of succession with the advice and approval of Thomas Cranmer, and he makes Jane Grey his heir. When he dies, they keep his death secret for 3 days so that they can find Jane and announce it to her. She's eventually asked to come up to London, a place called Zion House. I'm not sure if the building still stands. They had not told her. Nobody had told her she was first in line to the throne. If Edward died. Nobody had told her this. She comes in and suddenly the entire room hushes. They all kneel before her and declare her queen, head of the church, defender of the faith. And she's completely overcome. She actually faints. She has no idea. She faints, is prostrate on the ground. You can't touch the royal person. President Trump will be going over to England and meeting the Queen, I gather. I hope somebody schools him in some etiquette. He has at least what I've seen of him, yeah, he has a habit of touching people. You don't touch the royal person. Anyway, we assume he will be told what to do and what not to do, and nobody could touch her. She's the queen now, and they had to wait till she revives. And she revives, and amazingly, she kneels, and in the presence of all of them, prays out loud. If what has been given me is lawfully mine, may thy divine majesty, the Lord, grant me such grace that I may govern to thy glory, to the advantage of this realm. She is then rowed up to the Tower of London. The Tower of London was not simply, it was a royal residence at this point. It's not simply the place where people are incarcerated. It was that, but it was also a royal residence. She's rowed up to the Tower of London. A declaration is made to London that Jane is now, by the grace of God, Queen of England, France, The English didn't own a bit of France at this point in time. They'd lost it all. And this is a fiction that the English kings and queens will maintain for years, that they own France. But anyway, that's another story. Queen of England, France, and Ireland, defender of the faith. That was a title that was given by the Pope. It would have been Leo to Henry VIII. In 1519, Henry VIII had written a book against Luther. The Pope loved it. He called Henry the defender of the faith. When Henry broke with the Church of Rome, he kept the title. And if you ever go to England, get an English coin, it'll usually say, because of its Elizabeth D.G., Dei Gratia Regina, might be just an R, by the grace of God, Queen, F.D., Fide Defensor. And so she is still the defender of the faith, and so Jane was described. Defender of the faith and of the Church of England and Ireland, unto Christ on earth, the supreme head. When that declaration was made in London, Jane Grey was not well known. Probably most of the people in London would have been like, who on earth is this woman? As far as they knew, Mary was going to become queen. Jane signed a number of documents. If you want to actually see her signature, this is a copy. there is a copy on the back of the sheet, Jane the Queen. It's a beautiful handwriting. And in England at this time, probably only about 10 to 15% of women could read and write. And because you could read doesn't mean you write well. It's a beautiful, beautiful handwriting. And there are two documents we have of her signing that. There were a couple of royal banquets. She was never formally crowned. There is a recent, if you're interested in the kings and queens in England, I am, and have been since I was very little. There's a recent series of biographies being put out by Penguin. They're very small. They're about 80, 90 pages. And they go through all the kings and queens of England from William I to the present queen. And I noticed the addition of one and the absence of one. Oliver Cromwell's in there. I love Cromwell. I'm not sure what he's doing in there. He turned down the throne. He would have been horrified to find himself in this list of biographies. And Jane's not there. And I wondered if maybe it was because Jane was not formally crowned, but a man named Edward VIII, if you remember Edward VIII, who abdicated and caused such a constitutional crisis in the 1930s, he wasn't crowned either. So I'm not sure why they haven't chosen Jane. I'm thinking of writing to them and saying, you got to include Jane Grey. She becomes an iconic figure for the reformers, of a lover of the gospel who sealed her love of the gospel with her blood. And the person who makes her famous is John Fox in his Book of Martyrs. Every English Christian household had three books: the Bible, Pilgrim's Progress, and John Fox's Book of Martyrs. And Jane Grey, she's just a very famous figure. So I need to kind of get my nerve up and write to Penguin and say, you got to include Jane Grey. Anyway. So Jane was never formally crowned, signed a number of legal documents, had a couple of banquets. Mary was determined, though, she was not going to lose the throne. She raises an army, marches on London. Jane's own father, who had knelt before her, pledged his allegiance to her till death. As soon as he hears Mary's nearing London, he rides out to her and says, look, hey, we made a big mistake. I'm really a Catholic, and I'm on your side. Can you imagine having a father like that, who abandons his daughter at the first moment of trouble? And as often happens with traitors, Mary didn't trust him, and she chopped his head off within the following year. And she didn't trust his being a turncoat, and she figured, this guy's power hungry, and he'll use the earliest opportunity to seize power if he can. Jane is imprisoned. Jane does not expect, and in the early discussions with her sister or cousin, Mary is, I've got to imprison you. What you did was wrong. Jane is caught up. It's a fascinating story. Here is a woman caught up in the power politics of the day to some degree. She is committed to the Reformation, no doubt about that. Does she want to be queen? Probably not. Jane naively thought, once Mary came into London, well, one of her first things, can I go home now? You know, will you let me go back and live as a private citizen? And there was no way Mary was going to do that. Mary's got two problems with Jane. Number one, what she did politically. Number two, it's become very obvious to Mary that Jane is a figurehead for Protestant resistance. And not surprisingly, she will eventually condemn her to death. And so we come then to February the 10th, 2 days before her execution. I read portion of it, that portion there already, about what is faith, how are we saved. Here you see, what I love about this document, if you're ever teaching the Reformation, and you should obviously teach it. I hope that the time together, and it's been very brief glimpses, have given you a realization that this needs to be taught. It needs to be taught not simply in 2017. It needs to be regularly taught. I would encourage you as pastors in a cycle of Sunday school or some sort of adult education in a given year, you take a quarter, maybe 8 weeks, 10 weeks. Our church does a 10-week cycle where we have a church history thing. Have a church history segment. I think I would encourage all the adults and children to attend, but maybe you make it elective. But you should be teaching the history of the church as pastors. We include church history in the seminary curriculum, not simply as, hey, okay, you've had the hard stuff, the languages, and the queen of the sciences, systematic theology, and we've given you the scriptures because you're going to preach them. And then to kind of give you a bit of a relaxed entertainment, we'll give you a couple of courses in church history where you can kind of sit back and put your feet up and rest from all the hard stuff in seminary. No, we teach church history because we expect that those men who go out as leaders and women in the life of the church will teach it. This is a great year to start doing it, obviously, 500 years. But you should be regularly doing this. One of the best ways to teach what was the issues of the Reformation is this document, because it hits three key issues. The first one is, how am I saved? I've already read it. I won't read it again. Notice it's her emphasis. For Feckenham, it is faith and works that save. Jane does not deny that works are part of the package in this sense, is that true faith issues in works. She would affirm what Jonathan Edwards once said, which is that no one is saved by works, but no one is saved without them. It is a travesty in the 20th century that we've had people claim that you come down an aisle, say the sinner's prayer, and then you go and live like the devil for 30 years, and you're saved. That is not genuine saving faith. Genuine saving faith issues in works. Christians, as Titus puts it, are zealous for good works. They're not simply people who see the proverbial senior citizen crossing the road laden down with bags and you stop your car to help them across the road. You're the person who actually is thinking regularly, what good works can I do to help the people of God? But you are not saved by those. Those are not the foundation of your salvation. They are part and parcel of what issues from true faith. You'll also notice how he brings in this whole issue of love. Feckenham, if I have all faith without love, it's nothing. In the Roman Catholic mindset of this period of time, the Christian faith was understood as a ladder. In fact, there's a book written by Walter Hilton, late medieval Christian author, Catholic author, called The Ladder of Perfection. It has various rungs on that ladder. The first rung on the bottom is faith. That can't save you by itself. That you have to arduously work your way up that ladder until the top rung is love. It is not until you become a person of love like God that you enter into saving union with Christ. The idea being, like attracts like. The only people that God is going to admit to heaven are those who love like he does. The gospel turns it upside down. The reformers come along and say, hey, no, faith is not simply the beginning and we have to work our way up to love. Faith is what brings us into saving union with Christ, because Christ died for us when we were his enemies, when we were sinners. The truth of the gospel is God loves those who are not like him. And that's why that first part is very significant. And Jane understands, this is amazing, Jane understands that. Feckenham then changes the topic. How many sacraments be there? She will use the word sacrament. I should mention here, the word sacrament is from the Latin sacramentum. It's a Roman word, a Latin word. It means oath of allegiance. When you joined the Roman army, you took a sacramentum. The early Christian authors often used it of the Lord's Supper and baptism. In that context, I would argue, it's not a word I regularly use at all. Although our Baptist forebears did use it. Benjamin Keach uses it. William Kiffin uses it. Hansard Knowles uses it. They did not use it in either the 1644, 1646 confession or the 1677, 1689 confession. I know that. They used the word ordinance. The word sacrament in its original meaning is an oath of allegiance, and that's what baptism is. In baptism, I take an oath of allegiance to my captain, the Lord Jesus Christ, an oath to live for him. The Lord's Supper is a repeated affirmation of that. The Lord's Supper is a place of recommitment. And we, again, this is off to the side, evangelicals in the 20th century, because of the use of the altar call, have lost that richness of the Lord's Supper. It's not surprising that churches that regularly practice the altar call have a low view of the table. The table is the place where I declare my recommitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. And understood from the early Latin use of the word sacrament, sacramentum, that's not problematic. In the course of 1,000 years, the Middle Ages, the word sacrament becomes the idea of some sort of event that operates independently of my faith, with the idea almost of magic. And so early Baptists generally, although they sometimes used the term, shied away from it and used the term ordinance. How many sacraments be there? Two. One, the sacrament of baptism, the other, the sacrament of our Lord's Supper. Feckenham. No, there be seven. And the Roman Church had made sacraments out of marriage, becoming a priest, penance, last rites, what the priest says over you as you're dying, and so on. Notice Jane's response. By what scripture find you that? He doesn't answer her. Well, we will talk thereof. Hereafter, in other words, he doesn't have an answer. The Roman Church didn't have an answer. I mean, becoming a minister of the gospel is not a sacrament. But what is signified by your two sacraments? By the sacrament of baptism, I am washed with water and regenerated by the Spirit, and that washing to me is a token I am the child of God. The sacrament of the Lord's Supper is offered unto me as a sure and seal and testimony I am by the blood of Christ, which he shed for me on the cross, made partaker of the everlasting kingdom. Feckenham. What do you receive? Why, what do you receive in that bread? Do you not receive the very body and blood of Christ? Jane, no, surely I do not believe so. I think that at the supper I receive neither flesh nor blood, but only bread and wine. The which bread, when it is broken, the wine, when it is drunk, put me in mind how that for my sins the body of Christ was broken, his blood shed on the cross, and with that bread and wine I received the body benefits that came by the breaking of his body and the shedding of his blood on the cross for my sins. Why? Over the page. Why doth not Christ speak these words, take, eat, this is my body, require or we any plainer words? Doth he not say it is his body? James, I grant he says so, and so he says, I am the vine, and I am the door, but yet he is never more the vine nor door. Doth not St. Paul say, he calleth those things that are not as though they were? God forbid that I should say that I eat the very natural body and blood of Christ, for then either I should pluck away my redemption, either else there were two bodies, or two Christs, or else two bodies. The one body was tormented on the cross, and then if they did eat another body, then either he had two bodies, either else if the body was eaten, it was not broken on the cross. Or else if it was broken on the cross, it was not eaten of his disciples. And there's a part of that, it's not exactly clear. My suspicion is, as she wrote this down afterwards, it may have been done in a little bit of haste. But the main point is clear. If the disciples at the Last Supper were given the very body and blood of Christ, what body was on the cross? She understands the argument that Huldreich Zwingli had made against Luther, but it also applies to the Roman Catholic Church, which is if every place where the Lord's Supper is celebrated, if the bread and the wine are turned into the very body and blood of Christ, that means the humanity of Christ is omnipresent. Because it's going to be in every place wherever the supper is being celebrated. But if it's omnipresent, it ceases to be humanity. Humanity, the humanity of our Lord Jesus Christ, for it to be real humanity, has to be in one locale. That locale we call the right hand of the Father. It can't be omnipresent. In his deity, this is the great mystery of our dear Lord, in his deity, of course he's omnipresent. In his humanity, cannot be omnipresent, otherwise it destroys the reality of his humanity. That's a common, standard, reformed argument against the Lutheran position and against the Catholic position. Well, he then appeals to miracle. Why is it not possible that Christ by his power could make his body both be eaten and broken? So, eaten and broken, and it was a miracle. Just as to be born of a woman without the seed of man, walk on the sea without having a body, and others just like miracles, these are wrought by his power only. She will admit that's possible, but that's not what took place. Yes, verily, if God would have done it a separate miracle, he might have done so. But I say he minded no work or miracle, but only to break his body and shed his blood on the cross for our sins. I pray you answer me this one question. Where was Christ when he said, take, eat, this is my body? Was he not at the table when he said so? He was at that time alive and suffered not till the next day. Well, what he took he but bread, and what break he but bread, and what gave he but bread. Look what he took, he break, and look what he break, he gave, and look what he gave. That did they eat, and yet all this while he himself was at supper before his disciples, or else they were deceived. This, you might think this is a minor issue, and maybe for many in the 20th century, the Lord's Supper is not an important issue, which our Baptist forebears would have disagreed with them strongly. But all that aside, this issue was enough to secure your condemnation as a heretic in the 16th century. You might think, oh, the denial of the Pope's supremacy was the critical thing. It's very interesting. There were a group of spiritual Franciscans. Spiritual, that was the terminology to describe them. They built a town in southern Italy, Calabria, somewhere around 1300. They didn't like the Pope, and they put over the entrance to the town in Latin, the Pope is the Antichrist. Nothing was ever done to them. I mean, there were all kinds of people. The absolute supremacy and infallibility of the Pope was a debated issue by a number of Catholics in the medieval period. But if you deny, after 1215, the Third Lateran Council, that the bread and the wine are not the very body and blood of Christ, you are a heretic. And that denial alone was enough to secure your condemnation. Because upon that hung the entire system. The whole sacramental system hung on that. Because the only person who could turn the very body and the bread and wine into the body and blood was a priest. And he had to be duly consecrated by a bishop and the Pope. The whole sacramental system hung on this. And her argument is a standard reformed argument against this. She's aware of the the argument of Huldreich Zwingli against Luther. She probably learned it from Bullinger. But it's amazing to me. She's a 16-year-old girl. Think of this. How many of our young teens could stand against, in theological debate, the equivalent of an R.C. Sproul or a John MacArthur? Nobody knows Feckenham today. All these Catholic theologians are gone. That's his stature. And here is a young woman. What she studied is maybe a few books. She's had writings with some of these reformers. But she, by the grace of God, is a living witness of that. Those words of Jesus. Do not be afraid when they've been before authorities. The Spirit will give you the words in that day. There's a third issue. I mentioned this right at the beginning of my lectures, and that is the authority. By what do we know these truths? He immediately goes now for that issue, Feckenham. You ground your faith upon such authors as Say and Onsay, both with a breath, not upon the church to whom you ought to give credit. In other words, your problem, Jane, is you are listening to heretics. You need to listen to the church. The church should tell you what to believe. I grew up Roman Catholic, Irish Catholic, strong Irish Catholic home. I had a dear granny who prayed all her life for a priest in the family or a nun. I don't think being a church historian qualified. Definitely not a Protestant church historian. And the priest, we didn't have a Bible in the house. We didn't have a Bible in the house because we couldn't understand it. The priest had to tell us what to believe. And the priest said it, well, that's the truth. And that's what he's saying to her. You need to listen to the church. Her response, no, I ground my faith upon God's word. Praise the Lord. Not upon the church. We love the church. But a good church, as she's going to argue, is built on the word of God. If the church be a good church, the faith of the church must be tried by God's word, not God's word by the church. Neither my faith. Shall I believe the church because of antiquity? Shall I give credit to that church that taketh away from me that half part of the Lord's Supper? Will let no layman receive it in both hands but themselves. In the medieval mass, you only received the wafer, the bread. You did not receive the wine. And that was true down to Vatican II, 1960s. I remember my earliest memories of the mass are just getting the wafer and not the wine. In other words, as she'll say, the church changed what Jesus said. Which thing, if they deny to us, they deny to us part of our salvation. If I say it's an evil church, not the spouse of Christ, but the spouse of the devil that alters the Lord's Supper, and both take it from it and add it to it. To that church, I say God will add plagues. From that church, will you take their part of the book of life. I mean, this is really strong language. Do you not learn of St. Paul when he ministered to the Corinthians in both kinds, bread and wine? Shall I believe that church? God forbid. His response is feeble. Well, that was done of a good intent of the church to avoid a heresy that sprang within it. Jane, this is a standard Puritan argument before the Puritans. What, shall the church alter God's will and ordinances for the good intent? How did King Saul the Lord define? You remember Saul was commanded by the Lord to do a certain action, and he didn't do it. What she's arguing there is what God has commanded in his word, in worship, we must do. We do not have the right to change what he has explicitly commanded. With these and such like persuasion, he, Feckenham, would have had me lean to the church, but it would not be. Though many things were off, we reasoned, but these were the chief. These words were spoken openly. I think there she's hinting that there were more than her and Feckenham in the room. After this, Master Feckenham took his leave, saying he was sorry for her. He said, I'm sure we two shall never meet again. She's a heretic from his point of view. Notice the grace that is given her. She is only a day or two away from death. But the grace that is given to her to keep her head. One of the gifts of the Spirit, for 2 Timothy 1:7, God has given to his people a spirit of power and love and a sound mind. And the sound mind there is of keeping your head in fearful circumstances. True it is, quoth she, we shall never meet unless God turn your heart. For I am sure unless you repent and turn to God, you are in evil case. And I pray to God in the bowels of his mercy to send you his Holy Spirit. No, she prays for him. For he hath given you his great gift of utterance. She recognized that. If it pleased him to open the eyes of your heart to his truth. Haykin was so overwhelmed at this point, he said to her, he knew that Jane would not be given an evangelical chaplain to accompany her to her execution. And he asked her, could I come with you in those last moments? And she said, yes. Mary gave her two mercies. Number one, she didn't burn her. You always burned a heretic. You did not give them a quick death with the axe or a sword. On the front there, you've got a swordsman taking her head off. That's a very early print. That probably is not the case. Almost definitely from the evidence we have from bystanders, she was executed with an axe. And the second thing that Mary gave her was a private execution. If you ever go to the Tower of London, at the end of the tour, they bring you to a chapel called the Advincula, or Advincula Chapel. And as you come into the chapel, there's a little green space outside where it has a little sign, and it indicates on this spot were executed a number of people, about half a dozen. One of them is Anne Boleyn, and one is Jane Grey. And she gave her a private execution in a day when usually executions were public. There's little entertainment, so people would go and see people get executed. You might think that's gruesome. I think that's horrifying. But let me tell you, if that was reinstituted in our culture, there'd be a lot of people to see that. On the day of her execution, she gave a prayer book to her jailer, and then was escorted out. It was a blustery day, cold, February the 12th, 1554. She was given an opportunity to say a few words. She emphasized that she died as a Christian woman. And then Feckenham read Psalm 51, the penitential psalm. He gets halfway through it, and he breaks down weeping. There's no indication he ever became a believer, but he was very well aware of the wrongness of this scenario. He's supposed to be there to comfort her. She goes over to him, puts her arm around him to comfort him, and finishes the psalm. And then she's blindfolded, and at that point, the executioner will ask her for her forgiveness. And he should have led her then to the place where she would kneel down and then actually lay down and spread out her arms and put her neck on the block. He doesn't. He, too, is kind of overcome by the whole scene. And she's groping in the air. Where is it? Where's the block? And everybody was frozen. It would only have been minutes, but sometimes if you've ever been in these scenarios, it feels like hours. And finally, somebody, one of the few bystanders, jumps up on the scaffolding and takes her to the place, and she spreads out her arms as she lies down, and the headsman takes her head from her shoulders. Her last words in this world, Lord, into thy hands I commit my spirit. Well, not exactly the last words. She gave to the jailer her prayer book. And in the prayer book, she had written, to the end, I mean, she was that woman who had been educated. She wrote three sentences, one in Greek, one in Latin, one in English. And she writes this. That prayer book still exists. If justice is done with my body, my soul will find mercy with God. Death will give pain to my body for its sins, but my soul will be justified before God. nothing about works, by faith. If my faults deserve punishment, my youth at least, my imprudence were worthy of excuse. God and posterity will show me favor. The latter was certainly very true. Jane becomes, through John Fox's Book of Martyrs, what the Reformation was all about. It was faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that his blood alone cleanses from sin, and we learn that truth in God's holy word. But more importantly, as she passed from this life into the next, she knew the truth of those words, that she went immediately into the presence of her dear Lord, no purgatory, and that by faith alone in the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're here today, and I'm assuming you're all Christians, but I shouldn't, you may not be a believer. And you stand in the place of Feckenham. You are in an evil strait. And I urge you that the story we have been talking about is a fact of history, it's an element of history, but in it there is the truth of the gospel, that you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You call on him, you commit your life to him, and live for his glory, and that faith only in his blood saves. Thank you very much for the privilege of being with you. I have many fond memories of Missouri or Missouri. It's a curious thing to me what how the A gets in there, but I love language. Ever since Brother Gary Long invited me back in the 90s to attend the Spurgeon's pastor's conference, I came, I think, three or four times. I don't think I spoke every year, but that cemented friendships with Brother Gary and Terry Wolliver, and the great work that they're doing in Springfield and the reprinting of the Baptist literature and material, but also the meeting of many who have become very dear friends, people like Jim Eliff and Mark Coppinger and Don Whitney. It was at that conference I first heard my president, Al Mohler, speak. He was 35 at the time. I was just blown away. I couldn't believe that's the tremendous preaching and teaching. And then also connections with Midwestern. I nearly came to teach at Midwestern. Mark Coppinger interviewed me. Two things held me back was I wanted to be in a school with a PhD program, and they didn't have one in church history. But the other was my wife's parents, and we were, and still are, caregivers for them, and it's a two-day journey by car, and I just knew that that was going to be very difficult. And so we eventually didn't take that offer. But I'm deeply thankful for my connections with this state, and especially with you as believers, and then in more recent years to get to know Pastor Griever and his sons, and to be here. This, I think, my second time, maybe my third, I don't know. But thank you so much for being willing to have me come and speak about church history. I love church history. I think it's very important. And I pray God's richest blessing on all of you and the churches that you belong to, that you might recognize the ongoing significance of the past, use it as a guide stone. We don't live back there. We live now. But oh, that you might draw lessons from the past to be faithful in the present day. Let me pray and pray for all of you. Our great God, we thank you for the privilege that we've had to meet like this. Help us not to take such freedom for granted. We have been considering a period of time in which this freedom did not exist for some, and we thank you for this freedom. I thank you for each of the brethren gathered here, brothers and sisters, their different churches, and upon those churches and these brothers and sisters, I pray your richest blessing. May they, in this year, the 500th year of your great work of Reformation, remember those great watch cries of Christ alone as Savior, faith and grace alone as the means of salvation, Scripture alone is the basis of their faith, and your glory, Father, Son, and Spirit, as the heartbeat of their lives. Bless these brethren. Use them for your glory in this state, to spread your word and your kingdom. Bless the rest of the conference, and we thank you so much for this time. Amen.